dedicating the shiur לעילוי נשמת צירל בת אברהם קריגר, mother of our friend אברהם, עליה שלום, ולהבדיל לרפואה שלמה of ברוניה בת חניה, שיהיה רפואה שלמה בניסים, miracles beyond nature. So בעזרת השם, also we're dedicating the shiur לרפואת הרב שלום ארוש בן ימנה. ברוך השם, yesterday we saw a lot of people from our class, ברוך השם, the rest of friends in the Kotel המערבי, ברוך השם. So we learned a little bit on the Kriyat Shema. When you say Kriyat Shema with the right intention, you separate yourself from the soul of the Shifcha Bisha, the Erev Rav, woman that she's a prostitute, and glued yourself to 12 holy tribes of Am Yisrael. And the Shifcha Bisha, שהיא בבחינת, it's in the aspect of מפני שרי גבירתי אנוכי בורחת. I'm running away, I'm afraid, she's saying, from שרי, from שרה, the wife of Abraham, שהתאווה בורחת ונפרדת ממנה, that the desires, the lust, is running away and separate itself from her. אישה יראת השם היא תתהלל. ואם אינו משתדל לגרש את האישה זונה, so if he's not putting all of his effort to, how do you say, legaresh,
chase away
the woman that she's prostitute, azai hu bevchinat shifcha tirash givirta. So he's in the aspect of a woman slave that she inherits, that she takes all of what that her lady,
mistress.
Head. Like we said, it's all this or that. It's all lust and desires, or kedushat habrit, tikkun habrit. All that you're connecting yourself to righteous people, to the truth of this world, all that you're gonna find yourself attached to false leaders and liars and כי בשני הפסוקים האלו, because in those two verses, יש 12 תיבות. There are 12 words. כנגד 12 שבטיה. Equivalent to the 12 holy tribes. ו-49 אותיות, and also 49 letters. כנגד 49 אותיות שבשמות שבטיה. Equivalent to the 49 letters that's in the names of the holy tribes, tribes of Hashem. ובקבלת עול מלכות שמיים, and by that you accept on yourself yoke of heaven, הוא בחינת ים של שלמה, that is in the aspect of the sea of שלמה. The sea of שלמה means that you believe that שלמה, he was a king that had the control, the government on this world and on heaven also, on the world above. So you need to believe that Shlomo's got the sea. The sea means infinity, it's Yama Chochma. That he canceled himself so much that now he's able to reach and to achieve everything that he needs. For us, if we don't understand something, we need to learn, we need to ask, we need to go, we need to put an effort to find that. But the real righteous people in the aspect of Shlomo, they have the sea under their hands. Means, remember that once there was, I told you that there was an avrech from the yeshiva that disappeared for 4 days, went away from the house for 4 days, and people started to be worried, no one knew where he is. And someone came to Arav and asked him, Arav, what's going on with him? Maybe you should call the police, where is he? So Arav Shalom said, no, it's gonna be okay. don't do nothing. And again, they came to him and told him, Rav, come on, it's what's going on. So Rav Shalom closed his eyes like that and put his hand on his eyes, and he said, opened his eyes and said, don't worry. In 1 hour, 1 hour and a half, you're going to be back home. And this is what had happened. And again, it's not to idolize the tzaddikim and to make them to look, oh, we're so spiritual, because then you're going to come and you're going to try to talk to a rav and you will not going to understand what he's telling you. And I'm not talking about the block of English and Hebrew. I'm talking about that you come to the tzaddik. The tzaddik, he doesn't have the job to open and to show you that Hashem. He sees everything and he knows everything. And I'm not talking about Arav, I'm talking about tzaddikim, about real tzaddikim. They see everything, they know everything, and they have responsibility to help you, to bring you to the purpose, to the tachlit. So if it's a must that they're going to tell you something to help you, really it's going to help you, not going to damage you, so they're going to tell you. But usually it's just going to damage you if you're going to see. You're going to see which lifetime is it for you, who are you really, what's all of those secrets, all of the details, how much damage you created with all of your sins, your defect, what you defected, what you ruined, and what requires for your tikkun. If they're going to open those things for you, it's not sure that you're going to find the power to go for it, to finish the tikkun. It can make you weak. So sometimes, and most of the times, and this is why there is this kind of hester, that the tzaddikim are hiding the face, they're not sharing, they're not telling, because for us, the main thing is simplicity, is to keep on serving Hashem Yitbarach, because anyway you need to keep on serving Hashem Yitbarach. This is for sure. So if you bought it, and for sure you will, forever you're going to keep on serving Hashem Yitbarach, so it's a lot easier to tell you things, because nothing gonna reject you if you're so strong that you're holding. Can tell you more. But if everything is pushing you down to sadness, and that also needs to talk a little bit, because a lot of times when a man realizes that he really sinned, that he made something horrible, horrible damage, Ramash, you ruined, you spoiled something, I don't know what. You need to ask yourself that simple question. What Hashem wants from me now? Okay, I done that. I'm not trying to drop the responsibility and to not to take the responsibility. And no, I done that. It's a horrible thing. I wasn't supposed to do that. Now what Hashem wants from me? That I'm going to kill myself because of that? Even a person can find himself in prison after that he stabbed his best friend, killed him. I don't know what. Crazy situation, he beat his wife, I don't know what. He made an accident and killed a little boy, I don't know. Things can happen. Lo aleinu. And what are you going to do? What Hashem wants from me? This is what you need to ask. What? Now, okay. Cain killed Hevel, this is it. I killed Hevel, now. What, Hashem wants me to kill myself? No. Hashem wants me to do tshuva. Hashem wants me to work on my midot. Hashem wants me to be happy. Hashem wants me to believe that it was all from Hashem Yitbarach. And sometimes it's a wild journey to be happy after that you killed someone, after that you ruined your shalom bayit, that now you're divorced, that everyone can find himself chas shalom. But a man should come to a decision. I'm serving Hashem no matter what. I'm not looking on all of that, the what the Takadosh Baruch Hu is going to show to me in this world. I know that it's only part of this world. And in this world, Takadosh Baruch Hu is showing things. It's not the truth. It's not really what there is. You don't know. I told you that story that there was a woman that killed another woman in a car accident. She killed her and she couldn't forgive him herself. And she sent a letter to Rabbi David Abuchatzera, and Rabbi David Abuchatzera wrote for her an answer, you had to kill her. That woman that you killed, she killed your mother and you in a different lifetime in the Holocaust. And you had to kill her. You had to revenge that woman, had to kill her. It wasn't a free choice. You didn't have another option. It's from heaven, it was written that you're killing her. You had to. And this is it. And she died under your will, under your car. And this, sometimes there are things that you cannot control them. Hashem wants that. So what's the right perspective? How you look at things? When you're looking in front, when you're looking on the future, you know you have free choice. On the free choice, you're trying to do the best that you can. You pray and you do the best that you can do. This is one point of view. Second point of view, on the past. On the past, it's all from Hashem. Even though that one moment ago it was in your hand, now you need to believe that it was all from Hashem in Barach. Because there is no other way to look at life and to stay sane. There is no other way. Because if you're gonna think on your past, what have I done? What have I done? I wasn't choosing right, I was choosing wrong, maybe it's this, maybe it's that, maybe I was supposed to say this, I was supposed... You can die. You can be crazy from sadness, frustration, what have I done? I ruined so much. And it's not true. You don't have no free choice on those things that Hashem is doing and creating in the world. If in the future you're gonna look and gonna say to yourself, it's all from Hashem, whatever. So you're not gonna learn, and you're not gonna do tshuva, and you're not gonna do noid bodedut, and you're not gonna also be able to stay clean in Judgment Day. It means they're not gonna accept your nonsense that you say, no, it was all Hashem, it was Hashem, it was Hashem. No. Really, a man, they're forcing him to come down to this world, and they're gonna judge him against his will, on every act, on every action. And also, we know that it's all from Hashem. So, this is like we heard from Rav Shalom, this is the right perspective, right way to look, to see things, and to understand exactly how life really happens. And to know that tzaddikim, they have enormous power, they have a huge power, and they can reach every information and every salvation and everything that required. There was a lot of tzaddikim that made miracles that we cannot understand, that they changed nature totally, that they made miracles that Moshe Rabbeinu looks small and tiny when you think, and when you look at miracles, then you hear miracles that we cannot understand. There is a story that's written in a book that calls Chaye Moharan, but it's not the Chaye Moharan that we have now. This is the Chaye Moharan that's been written by Rabbi Naftali. Rabbi Naftali was a student of Rabbeinu. He was the second student of Rabbeinu. First was Rabbi Natan, and then there was Rabbi Naftali. But Rabbi Naftali, no one knows almost nothing about him. He was very hidden. Rabbi Naftali was very, very hidden. Rabbi Naftali, for an example, Rabbeinu told him that he have to give a lesson to teach in Seuda Shlishit, third meal of Shabbos, in a closed room to the angels. This was the job of Rabbi Naftali. Every third meal he was closing the door, sitting alone and teaching Torah to the Malachim. It's Rabbi Naftali. So Rabbi Naftali also wrote the book Chaye Moharan, Life of Rabbi Nachman Breslev. We don't have that edition. There are mamash few copies of that hidden book, and no one is publishing it for now. And in that book there is a story, for an example, that on the trip to Eretz Israel, on the boat, Rabbeinu, he met one of the students of Baal Shem Tov, that assumed that maybe it's written over there, I don't know, I didn't hear who that student was, that he assumed that he is the Mamshich Darko, the one that continues the way of the Baal Shem Tov. He knew that he is the one that, and he was also on his way to Eretz Israel, and he was sure that he's bringing Mashiach now, and more and more and more. And actually he wasn't, but he thought that he was. And it's a huge righteous man. If we to know the name of that righteous man, just gonna damage us, because we don't have the ability to understand how huge people like those had mistakes like that. But he thought that he was the one that supposed now to bring Mashiach, to go to Eretz Israel. He's the, how you say, Mamshich Darko? Wow. Predecessor?
No. Successor.
Successor. Yosef. So, he thought that he was the successor of Rabbal Shem Tov HaKadosh. And he met Rabbeinu on the boat. Rabbeinu met him on the boat to Eretz Israel. And he said to, and they started a certain conversation, and he wanted to show Rabbeinu that really he is the one that have the power, that he... And So he made a miracle to show Rabbeinu, a mofet, to show Rabbeinu that he is the one that got the power of Moshe Rabbeinu and of Abal Shem Tov. And what he done? He took a seed, put it in his hand, and threw it like that on the air. And when it fell on the boat, or that it was on the sea or something like that, on the ground, something. So it became immediately, it grew and became to be a tree that made fruits. And every foot that fell down on the ground been planted immediately and grew and made another tree with another fruits and just like that. Made a mofet like that. So he shown that he's got huge power. So it's written over there that Az Rabbeinu bakalo et hayam. So Rabbeinu opened the sea to show him that even though that you have enormous power, but Moshe Rabbeinu, it's me, it's not you. You have huge powers. As Rabbeinu bakalo et hayam. So Rabbeinu opened the sea for him, that he's gonna see, okay, nice powers. And it's written over there that righteous man made tshuva immediately, started to cry and ask from Rabbeinu to explain to him how to do tshuva on his avonot and how to fix himself and what he should do to fix himself, and he been humiliated. He became to be a real Baal Tshuva. Started to do Tshuva on his imaginations, that he thought that he was the successor of a Baal Shem Tov. Nice, so this is what that we said. When a person is accepting on himself yoke of heaven, that is in the aspect of Yam Shel Shlomo, means faith in Chachamim, that you understand that you are zero and that the righteous people are huge and they can reach the sea. They have every information in their hands, under their hands. Rabbi Natan in Likutei Halachot writes that the main intention that a man should have when he's saying Amavdil ben Kodesh Lechol is to make a difference between us, Am Israel, to the righteous man. Amavdil ben Kodesh, it's the righteous man, it's the tzaddik, Lechol, to us, to accept of us. You cannot reach him. He's somewhere else. And even if you can talk to him and you sit with him, you should know 100%, even that it's going to be very hard. And when I heard that thing 2 days ago, I said, it's so frustrating, because this is how I accepted it. And I said, it's so frustrating. And I accepted it, that even if you sit with him, and you feel like you sit with your best friend and he's talking to you, mamash, in the same eye, with same height with you, and he's just going down to the place that you are at to be there for you, to help you in whatever, and he's just able to give you the feeling that you're in the same place. But actually, he's not with you. Why? Because he's glued to Hashem. He is with Hashem, like we talked yesterday. The tzaddik that canceled himself to Hashem Yitbarach totally, he is not here. He is with Hashem. He is part of Hashem. He is with Hashem. Like the Zohar Kadosh is saying, An Pe Shechinta, the face of the Shechina. The Lamed Vav Tzaddikim, they are the face of the Shechina. You look at his face and you see Hashem. For you, that your faith is not solid, not strong, not high enough, it's hard to understand. You say, no, he understands more, maybe he knows more, he's got more experience, like that he let you think. But actually, he doesn't need nothing. It's written in Chaye Moharan, the regular Chaye Moharan, the one that we can accept, that we can understand. Over there it's written that on the journey to Eretz Israel, on the way back, if I'm not wrong, or maybe on, I don't remember in which direction, that Rabbeinu couldn't find in what to make himself alive, to lachiot et atzmo anymore, so he had to eat. So he had to eat something. But for a certain time before, he testified himself, I have wisdoms that you can live without eating and drinking based on those wisdoms. Moshe Rabbeinu, 40 days and 40 nights, 3 times in a row, 120 days, wasn't eating and wasn't drinking, and he wasn't thirsty, he wasn't fasting. He was in a different place. He was busy. He was with, yes. Like that you can find yourself for 5, 6, 10 hours not thinking about food, even 24 hours if mamash you're busy. If you're really busy, you can take it longer. It just depends how long you're holding on with Hashem Yitbarach. It's don't need to try that, don't need to test it, just need to understand that it exists. When you really, really, a lot of stories on tzaddikim that they had to go to surgeries or something like that, and they said to the doctor, no anesthesia. And he said, you cannot go through that process without it. So they said, no, just let me get into the sugiya for 1 minute, and this is it, you can do whatever. And this is actually what had happened. They were concentrating in the sugiya, 30 seconds, and this is it. And they cut them, opened them, made surgeries, things that you cannot understand, and they didn't feel nothing. Thousands of stories like those. You don't need to be not in the level of Moshe Rabbeinu and not even close to Moshe Rabbeinu to be in that level even. That for us, it's impossible to understand. But somehow you can start think about it, to believe really, oh wow, really it can happen, wow. So this is how you grow. So to accept on yourself yoke of heaven, it's in the aspect of Yam Shel Shlomo. By that, hu nifrad mi nishmotehen de Erev Rav. You separate yourself from the souls of Erev Rav. Like we said, that the souls of Erev Rav, they're inside the person. You separate yourself from the bad will, from lusts and desires. They're inside. All of those foreign thoughts, all of those foreign faiths, imaginations. I am, I am, I am. I remember once I had a dream that I went to sleep. There is a twilight zone like that when you go to sleep, that you half awake and half see things. And before I went to sleep, I was praying. I was during it bodedut, and I was praying on that thing of the will, on the neshama. And I remember that while I went like that to sleep, I could see, I don't remember nothing of it, but I remember that I saw that neshama that I'm talking about, it's so beautiful, it's so amazing, it's so great. And then the word ani, me, is so ugly. And it was so, it's such so different things. There is no connection between you to your soul. You is the prison of your soul. So think about the connection between the prisoner to the jail itself. What's the connection to the gatekeeper? What's the no connection at all? They're different, as they are against each other. This is your soul. Your soul is so beautiful. Your soul is so amazing. Your soul is attached to Hashem Yitbarach, of each and every one of us. Of each and every creation of HaKadosh Baruch Hu that's got life inside, life. So beautiful, so amazing, so great. And you have it. And all of the world is coming to fight with you on that and to hide that and not to let you see that. And this is who that you are. This is the body. The bad attributes, the selfish will, the lust, the desires, the totally different. So by that you can connect. When you accept on yourself yoke of heaven, means that simple faith to say whatever Hashem wants. When you do that, you separate yourself from all of the neshamot that are erev rav, that they are blend, that they're mixed, they're on the border. Like the Rambam is explaining that all of the foundations, the yesodot of the creation, they're meeting in a certain point. Means the water and the earth, there is mud, and the earth and wind, there is dust, and you have the middle, and fire and water, you have steam. You have, so in every one of them you have the middle. So the neshamot erev rav, they're standing in that place, and you have that place. It's like the klipat noga, the husk of noga, that is the border between kedusha and tuma. So when you are concentrate in that, to accept on yourself yoke of heaven, to say, I want what that Hashem wants. I want what that Hashem wants. I'm accepting on myself the will of Hashem. By that, you separate yourself from that husk, from that middle, from that twilight zone, from that place that is mixed, good and bad. Etzadat tov vera. Shehi shifcha bisha, that this is that woman slave of false, of lie, isha zona, woman that she's a prostitute, ונכלל בנשמות שבטי יין, you include yourself in the holy tribes of Hashem. בחינת אישה יראת השם, in the aspect of אישה, that she is יראת השם. Azai, so then, הוא בחינת סגירת עיניים, it's in the aspect of closing your eyes, בשעת קבלת עול מלכות שמיים, in the time that you accept on yourself the yoke of heaven. Can we learn from that that a person that is walking with his eyes open, he is not accepting on himself the yoke of heaven? We can learn it. You're closing your eyes in the time that you accept on yourself the yoke of heaven. So if your eyes are open, you're not doing it now. The time of Kriyat Shema, we explained yesterday that the time to keep the mitzvah is in the time that you keep the mitzvah, in the time of Kriyat Shema, in the time of putting tefillin. But it's not only like that. Maybe this is the most special time. But when you're tying, when it's written, Ukshartam le'ot al yadecha, you tie the tefillin on your hands. It's not only in that time. It's especially in that time. This time you have a certain segula, power, to help you to tie HaKadosh Baruch Hu on your actions, on your hands, on your face, all day long. So this is the beginning. This is the start point. But actually, all day long, you have to keep Kriyat Shema, to remember Hashem and to walk with Hashem and to tie Hashem between your eyes, to remember Hashem, and on your hands, on your actions, on all of your on Viyadav Emunah, that your faith is going to be connected to Hashem. Also, the faith have to be connected to Hashem, to believe in Hashem. How many mistakes people can have, Baruch Hashem? People can say, I believe, and he doesn't. And he can say, and he can give lectures, can be rabbi, I don't know what. And he doesn't have a drop of faith. Maybe also almost doesn't have a crack in his kfirot. So far from Hashem, totally separated from Hashem. All full with lusts and desires and selfish will and so addicted to lust and desires and honor, respect and anger and so separated from HaKadosh Baruch Hu, totally. And he's gonna teach people on faith and gonna explain faith and Torah. So, need to close the eyes in time of accepting yoke of heaven, lehorot, to show, she'al yedei kabbalat ol malchut shamayim, that by that you accepted on yourself the yoke of heaven, hu bivchinat ulimta shapirta, you become to be in that aspect of that beautiful woman, deleit la'einin, that she doesn't have no eyes. What it means? That shehi hata'ava shekolelet hamidot ra'ot shel 70 leshonot. That she is separated, that you are separated from that main lust, that all of 70 languages are attached to that, wrapped after that lust, lust for women. By accepting on yourself yoke of heaven, you say, first of all, Elokeim shel ele sonezima, first of all. It's the hardest thing of them all. This is the biggest tava of them all. It's the hardest tava of them all. But also, when you look at it from the side, it's the biggest nonsense of them all. There is nothing over there. It's imaginations, it's lies. Just those lies have all of the power. They just gave from heaven, from the Sitra Achra, they gave the power on that. So this is it. Now it's a war, and even after you understood it once and understand it once and you thought, all right, I had it, in the next day you can fall in the same swamps, in the same filth, like nothing, like you're ignorant, like you never learned nothing in your life. And so how can it be? Because like we said, you need to, how you said, letzaref ulezakech, to purify, to refine yourself. So it's a process that have to take time, have to work on that, have to pray on that, to reveal your real will to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And how you're going to reveal the real will to HaKadosh Baruch Hu? If you're saying it once, it's not enough. No, it's not enough. And if you're going to see that really when they're testing you second and third and fourth time, and even 1 month or 1 year or a decade, what you're going to do then? Then suddenly you realize that you have a crack in your will, that your will is not so strong, that actually you also had in mind to enjoy and to keep on receiving honor and to keep on thinking on yourself and your laziness and on and on and on and on and on. I'm going to share with you because I don't have a choice. Really, the truth, what? I'm going to hide? No reason to hide the nonsense of my life. So, for an example, my wife, she had a nice fight with me, Baruch Hashem, this morning. And she told me, you're so selfish and you think only about yourself, and on and on and on. Everyone knows those lectures, Baruch Hashem. And I told her, I'm not arguing, no, I don't think, Chas Shalom, that you're wrong. I'm sure that you're right, don't have a doubt about it. But I don't know what to do. I'm doing my best. I'm trying. I'm really trying. So she said, this is why I'm always telling you that there is no chance that you're going to be able to fix it. This is her reason for despair, because she really understands that I'm trying real hard, but I'm not bringing no results. Means that there are things that she still needs to receive from me, and I don't understand what she wants, Ribono Shel Olam. Don't understand, just don't have those tools. Don't understand, I want to. Don't hear it, I don't feel it, what can I do? So I told her, I don't know what to say. So she said, this is the difference between you and a Rav. And I was quiet, just all to learn the lesson, and it's beautiful. And she said, a Rav is always there for the Rabbanit when she needs him. He's always there, and he's a lot busier than you, and he's got a lot more things on his mind than you. And he's always there for her. What can you answer? You're right. I'm sorry, I'm gonna try. She said it's not gonna help, and you need to fight now against despair, against sadness, and to say no. Ezrat Hashem, we will. I'm gonna pray, I'm gonna succeed. I believe Hashem is rebuking me, so he wants me to succeed. And you're going to the field, you don't know what. And this is why we're saying, Shir Lama'alot, Me'ayin Yavo Ezri. The help gonna come from nowhere. You go on the field, you don't know what to ask. Shalom, help me, I don't know what I need. I don't know what I'm lack of. Please, Shalom, let me be a human being. Let me be sensitive. Let me feel that there is another person over there. Let me. And you're trying, and it's not that you're not trying. It's not that you're not burning your life on trying to help people. But Hashem Yitbarach, He wants you, how He said that? To refine yourself and to purify yourself again and again in another layer, to another depth, to another place that you haven't revealed before. So it's all good. When you want to serve Hashem Yitbarach, when the fire is coming on your face, it just removes, takes away all of the husks, all of your lusts, all of your desires. And if you're holding on, after that attack, you find yourself cleaner, calmer, safer, more relaxed, more wise, more sensitive, with less husks, less contamination. So you need to go inside the fire again and again and again, because the tshuva have to be tshuvat ha-mishkal. Exactly like that, you sinned, you have to be purified. So if you contaminated yourself until the bones, so you have to go inside the fire back until the bones. If you enjoyed from lust and desires and lies and false until the end, mamash, until as much as you could achieve. So exactly like that, you have to run for Hashem Yitbarach and to be afraid from Hashem Yitbarach and to accept on yourself the yoke of heaven in Mesirut. Exactly the same. And if not, it's going to be a shame in the world to come. It's going to be a disgrace in the world to come. And we don't want it. So we're choosing, actually, to bring those situations on ourselves. This is what it calls tshuva me'ahava. You say, I want it. I accept on myself the yoke of heaven. It's hard. It's humiliating to realize where you're holding, how much you need to fix, how much you ruined. It's humiliating. But after you're going to be humiliated, you're going to be humble. And you achieved something huge. You achieved something that all of the Torah depends in that. Matan Torah, Torah been given on the lowest mountain of them all, Sinai, the mountain that didn't have no hirhur, no thought, no assumption that maybe the Torah going to be given by him. The Torah been given by him means that as long as you think maybe the Torah can be given by me, I'm a vessel, maybe, when you have still that maybe, You're not qualified. You're not there. You're one of those mountains that been disgraced by HaKadosh Baruch Hu, been rejected. First of all, humility. Humility. And for that we're far from it, far, far, far from humility. This is why we have to fight on that. And the fact that you're far, it doesn't mean that you're not going to reach it maybe even in one day. Like I told you on that dream that I had with Rav Shalom, that I told him that I think that I need to start maybe doing longer in Bodeduyot and close my eyes and maybe to develop myself spiritually and maybe after a while. And he told me, maybe it's going to happen in 5 minutes, in a minute, maybe. Why you think that the process of tshuva going to be so hard? You need to accept on yourself that whatever going to be, and you accept it. If you're doing it with all of your heart, it's going to happen on the spot. HaKadosh Baruch Hu doesn't want to make you sorry. He doesn't need you to suffer. It's not that someone is gaining something out of your suffering, out of your effort. It's all nonsense. It's just to bring you to humility. It's just to conquer, to surrender all of husks and desires, all of the imaginations of certain being, of arrogant, that you have powers, you're gonna complete your tshuva, you're gonna, I am. Imaginations. I'm not exist. Thank you, Hashem Yitbarach, on everything. Hopefully, I'm gonna make you happy. When you come to that place, Hashem gonna make you achieve that. Really, you're gonna make him happy. And then a righteous man can be also a shoemaker, and you will never gonna understand what he is doing as a shoemaker. He is saving lives every time that he's making a shoe, every time that he's doing something small, when he eats crackers, when he drinks water, when he's blessing Shakol Niyabit Vaho. You don't understand what he is doing, and you don't want to be a shoemaker. You don't understand. You want to be a rabbi, you want to be a talmid chacham, you want to be rich, whatever. All kinds of imaginations. Just because you're not glued to the purpose. The purpose is to be with Hashem. And when you're with Hashem, you can be a shoemaker. Hashem is there. In your place, in your store. You don't know what happened. In that store of the shoemaker, how you say, sandlaria? How you say that store?
Shoemaker.
Store, shop. In Tel Aviv, of Rabbi Yaakov, Moshe Yaakov Rebikov, that was the head of the Lamed Vav. And all of the Lamed Vav was coming to his store and learning secrets over there. Rabbi Yosef Voltoch and other righteous people, Rabbi Moshe Mandel, huge righteous people, hidden righteous people would run to his store. The Chazon Ish was going to his store. One of the times, one of his helpers that took him to that shoemaker, to Rabbi Moshe Yaakov Rebikov, the Chazon Ish, he took him, he asked him, why are you so excited from that shoemaker? All of the time needs to take you here and bringing him there and he's entering inside. So he looked at him and he told him to that helper, you should know that that shoemaker is the head of the Lamed Vav, hidden righteous people. Wow. No one knows, a store, a shop in Tel Aviv, in South Tel Aviv, you don't know. You don't know. You don't know. The imagination brings you, no, I don't want to be a shoemaker, I don't want to work, I don't want to clean floors, I don't want to do this, I don't want to be a cook, I don't want to work in cleaning, I don't want to work in shiputzim, I don't want to, because you don't want Hashem. If you will want Hashem, you still want the success of this world, you still want to be rich, you want to be famous, you want people to respect you, you want people to, I don't know what, like that there are people, but there's no people. It's all faces, levushim, outfits of Hashem Yitbarach. It's all kutsha brichu, shchinte, yudke vavke, and adni. This is it. Man, male, and female, it's yudke vavke, and adni. This is it. Kutsha brichu, shchinte. You see a man, kutsha brichu. You see a woman, shchinte. This is HaKadosh Baruch Hu dressed himself now. This is it. This is reality. This is truth. This is how life goes. This is the truth. This is the circuit of life. There is nothing. There is only Hashem. And that curtain of imagination. If you work to break it, finally you find Hashem in everything. When you eat Hashem. You breathe Hashem. You drink Hashem. You see Hashem. Everything is Hashem. Enod milvado. Nothing except of Him. And if not, so you have your imaginations. Oh, my wife, my friends, my students, my food, my parnasa, my boss, my car. Oh, my car. Oh, my car. Oh, my car. Start praying. Oh, my car. Imaginations. Nothing exists. En od milvado. You don't know that music. No, bring one. Need to make a song. So when a person is closing his eyes means not to fall to lies of this world, to believe in the power of imagination, that this thing have the power to give me life, to give me joy, to give me happiness. Oh, that thing, you're walking after your eyes. The ta'ava ula enayim, the last depends in the eyes. Ikra de'itz rabisha is going on arayin, on lust for women, and the main opening that the yetzara can enter into the person is through the eyes. This is what we heard by Rav Cheshin from the Zohar HaKadosh. That the main holding of the Yetzer Ha on the person is through his eyes. So needs to close your eyes. And what it means to close the eyes, I'm going to tell you a small thing, what the Rav Shalom said, last thing, from Shabbos. He said that the guarding the eyes is spiritual. It's not only the physical guarding your eyes also, but not only, just it's a spiritual thing that what? That you need to think what that thing is, how that thing is connected to me. What's my connection to that thing? Someone is telling you, hey, you know, that person, he gained $1 million. What's the connection of that to me? I don't want to look at that. Oh, it's him. What's my connection to that? I don't have connection to all of those things. This is what it means to guard, spiritual guarding your eyes. That you're not connected, that you're saying, ma ze shayach elai? What's the connection? How it's related to me? It's not. It's not connected to me. It's not belong to me. Not those women, not those cars, not those houses, not those gardens. They're never going to be mine. There's no issue, reason why I should look on all of those houses and all of those women and all of those cars. They're not mine. I'm looking what Hashem wants for me. This is real spiritual, the beginning and the end of guarding your eyes. Because if a person is guarding his eyes physically, but his heart is still attached to all of those things around him, so it's contaminated, it's not pure at all. You're pure when you're inside your Dalet Amot, and you're concentrated in yourself, in what that you have to accomplish, to do for Hashem Yitbarach. You ask yourself what Hashem wants for me all of the time, and you're just doing whatever Hashem wants from you. Thank you. Chazak u baruch.